The following production is rated TV-MA. It contains inappropriate conduct, coarse language, and brief nudity. Please put the women and children to bed before viewing. The actors in said production are professionally trained, and we strongly encourage you not to try the following at home. The actors donated their time for this production, so please send any monetary donations to Bill Bomb D Productions, P.O. Box 1234, here in Ohio, 44839.
Jonathan's first true love in life came in the form of an Olympic gold medalist gymnast by the name of Dominique Muciano. His appreciation may have stemmed from being a balance beam champion at the Ann Arbor YMCA at the age of 4, but also John grew a fondness for Dominique for her excellence in the floor exercise at the 1996 Summer Olympics in Atlanta. Luckily for Shannon, that romance fizzled out, and it no doubt has made Jonathan a more rounded individual. Jonathan spent a good deal of his younger years in deep thought up in his family treehouse. There he schemed to accomplish a lifelong goal of being married to a beautiful wife and to live the early years of his life in the Windy City and work for a highly respected financial institution. It was in this treehouse that Jonathan found his true self or calling. As a young Ralph Waldo Emerson, he figured out a plan for his life that would impact all those close to him in a supernatural manner. Jonathan has always been an animal lover. Most especially, he has always loved his family dogs, ranging from Missy the Great Black Lab to Kaline the current Yellow Lab. Jonathan always wanted to spend time with his dogs, even though Missy bit him in the hand for stealing her bone. That did not stop Jonathan from cuddling with his dogs.
Although growing up in a predominantly scarlet and gray area, Jonathan never wavered of his love for the Michigan Wolverines. From Bo Schembechler through Gary Moeller to Lloyd Carr, and even through the last glorious years of Rich Rodriguez.
Damn, what the heck was that called by Rodriguez?
Jonathan, it's just a game.
John has never missed a beat while loving on his team from the cesspool of the world. Although he has yet to see an outright national championship in anything other than underwater basket weaving, okay, they did win the men's basketball championship in 1989. But let's be honest, Ann Arbor is as close to Cleveland sports as Chris Webber is to a timeout.
Jonathan, also known as the Trash Man or the Dominator, instituted his dominance on the basketball court at a young age and never looked back. And also at Thanksgiving, as the Zimmerman cousins soon came to realize. Even though he was known as a dirty player at times, he used his ogreish size and girth to back his opponents down and then run through them on his way to the rim. Dino Caparini once called Jonathan a yo-man on the blocks. It is still unclear whether that meant John would yell to Greg Cobb, his point guard, "Yo man, give me the ball," or if it meant John would literally demonstrate his dominance on the lower blocks. This is the front entrance of Huron High School, where Jonathan established himself as the godfather of the dangerous and notorious gang known as the Dinosaur Club. As president of this underground cult, he was better known as Stega for the better part of 4 years at Huron High. His status as Stegosaurus made him a well-known and highly feared but respected leader within these hallowed halls. Stego was also known for undercutting the lunch ladies, painting this particular rock, and organizing illegal gambling operations. Little did Stega know that his principal, who Jonathan called Mr. Rooney, would later be his father-in-law.
Jonathan, I know we've had to do this many times before, but if you don't behave, you're going to be looking at another detention. Jonathan, I got another complaint from the lunch ladies. When are you going to close your cafeteria?
Jonathan's hidden talent lied in being the John McEnroe of the Sandusky Bay Conference from 1996 to 1999. Coach Jim Wooster claimed John had Andre Agassi's skill with John McEnroe's anger. If he wasn't constantly being docked points for taunting players and throwing rackets, there's no doubt he would have multiple state championships sitting on his mantle. This may have been John's true calling in life, as he undoubtedly had both the skill and agility to make a lasting impact on the tennis landscape in America.
Growing up, Jonathan spent many a days and nights with friends sipping Kool-Aid and playing euchre in the infamous cop garage. If Jonathan ever got frisky, or, as we often thought, got a sugar high from all the Kool-Aid he was drinking, he was known for dancing on the pool table to his favorite song by PM Dawn.
Jonathan, early in his courtship with Miss Folger, tried to impress her in many ways.
I don't know about that.
From meeting her at Spreader's to presenting her with one of her favorite dishes. One such memory was a certain Thanksgiving day when he presented her with her favorite dessert. When everybody failed to pick up the assortment of cheesecake, Jonathan took it upon himself. He slowly took it from the fridge and tried to present it to the table pizza boy style. In true Jonathan fashion, it fell straight to the ground. All was not lost on his antics, as Shannon was undaunted by this and still ate the cheesecake. Can't get enough of your love, babe. Girl, I don't know, I don't know why. Can't get enough of your love, babe. Jonathan spent many a days of his life on the best sweet corn farm in America. He was once dubbed director of field operations for his unwavering qualities of leadership he bestowed upon the migrant workers at the farm. When his boss at the farm, Gordon, aka Plowboy, Hayseed, Gordo, Gordman, Hon Highboy, Blue Pants, and White Shirt Hon, was quoted, Jonathan was as steadfast as a moldboard on a five-bottom plow. The late Glenn Trigger Beatty said of Jonathan, you're a man amongst men and a true champion of the corn. The ghost of Jonathan's past as a bona fide corn picker will live on in the fields of Bogart Road forever. She thinks my tractor's sexy.
I would say Jonathan's going to be a chartered member of the Hall of Fame at Hunt Farms. He was on the probably the best picking crew I ever had, along with Dan. We filled a wagon load of corn in an hour. And that's probably a record that'll probably never be broke. And I have to say that I always enjoyed talking with Jonathan about playing on the football team, playing football. And he always said you got to play with a lot of heart. But I know that Jonathan's got a big heart, and so does Shannon, because she always did a real good job babysitting our children, which I was real thankful for. And I want to say that a big heart's going to make a big difference in their marriage. And it'll carry them through their marriage. So I want to say congratulations to both of them, and I wish you the very best.
Jonathan, it's been great being your brother, especially in the last couple of years. Everything from the NCAA tournament game you took me to in Cleveland to me dominating you in the wrestling matches. You got yourself a keeper. Congratulations.
John and Shannon, at this point of the wedding, I probably had a couple cocktails in me, and therefore, any speech that I give is best to be done in advance to this point. I'm really proud of both of you guys. I wish you nothing but the best in the future. John, you've been a great friend of mine for a number of years. You've done a lot for me, and I hope to pay you back for that in the future also with your family and kids. And I can't think of a better combination than you and Shannon together. So I wish you nothing but the best in the future.
Congratulations.
Peace out. Say